for the warm-up version, also ideal for a 2-5. So Marty, you're going to be going cross-court. Ken and I, at the same time, are going cross-court. And all that's going to happen, Ken, is when the ball comes to you, you pop it up, let it bounce, and send it back. Okay, so I pop it up, and then I send it back to Ken, and then Dave, you can come in here. So go ahead and start. Now, imagine this being my 2-5 team, 3-0 team, and they're doing this. Usually what makes a player 2-5 is either inexperience or age. Right? Maybe they got a lot of experience, but now they're on the decline, and they're taking lessons to kind of like avoid getting worse. From this, it's not particularly earth-shattering, but guys, whatever ball you pop it up with, send it with the other shot. So if you pop up a forehand, move around and send it with a backhand, so you get a little more movement to it. And this is what, cooperative or competitive? Cooperative. Now, let's turn this into competitive, guys. See what happens if I just say that. Oh, by the way, the boundaries are the two service boxes, okay? So we're going to be competitive, but if they're smart, they're going to figure out how to be competitive. Now, us coaches, here I can tell you the secret. The way you're competitive with this is bump it up close to the net and angle the snot out of it. And since we've got a lot of room in the sides here, now we're getting interesting. Okay. This is also a variation that we would do with juniors for a warm-up, because I want them getting understand skills and getting them started. So, that's called absorber bridge, but that's only one way. That's the 2-5 way. Now, time out. Good call. We're going to everybody back it up to the baseline. This is probably a 3-5 way of doing it. What's going to happen is now the strokes become full strokes, and you're going to pop it up to each other and then just spank it back. You're going to, so be ready, crowd, because we're going to know how good we are controlling things. Ready, go. Two things going on at once. Give it a whack, because this thing, this court is kind of not lively. Just like red clay. Pop it up. So players, or coaches, here's the rules of this game. When you pop it up to yourself, you have to pop it up to no man's land. You cannot send it inside the service line. If you pop it up backwards by accident, so be it. You guys, let's put a little more gas on it. My 3-5s are a little stronger than this. A little burner. Good. So it's a lot of movement if they're doing it right. But here's the takeaway as you guys keep doing this. For juniors in particular, club players, they're not too smooth at taking power off the ball. I've asked juniors, good juniors, what would you want to take power off the ball in tennis? And sometimes they'll look at me like, do you want to take power off? Would that ever happen? So a lot of times, us older guys, we can do this pretty good. Like you can rip a ball at 100 miles an hour, I can pop it up right in front of myself. But for juniors, they got kind of hands of stone. This is the first skill. Now, so this would be in the cooperative version, the 3-5 version, for example. Now, we're going to finish with the highest version. This would be now if we're going to do it for my competitive junior, for 4 or 5 players. So guys, now the drill is this. Let's hold up. You're going to try to hit winners on that second ball. Okay, you're trying to win the point. It's a battle. The better players, if you see 2-5-0 players do this, it's really a workout because they all have enough skill to like control it, and then they come up and they just wail on it, but the other guy can control it, and they get this big bash going back and forth. Now remember, court's a little soft, so give it a good smack. Ready to go. This is a competitive version, keep the score. Remember, you can't be passing it way up there. Nice hands, Ken, let us soften them up. Ooh. Nice. Boom. Pass it forward, yeah, get it up there. Nice, Marty. Oh, English on it. Good, save it. Nice. Keep this back. Nice. Keep this back. All right, time. So, that's the name of that drill is called absorbent grip. But the whole message here that I'm trying to get across this first half hour is that you can do drills. I want you to participate in this little survey. Raise your hand if you agree with this upcoming statement. And then, if you don't, you raise the other hand. Okay, here's the statement. A drill, any drill, absorb and rip, let's say, could go great with Coach Jorge running it with these 6 players. And then all you do is you take Coach Jorge away, put in Coach Jimmy, same players, same drill, and the drill might all of a sudden stink. Raise your hand if you think that's a true statement. It is absolutely true. OK, is not the drill only. I mean, the drill has to be solid and have purpose, but it's real easy in this game to kind of like, oh, that drill stinks. Right? Maybe the pearl stinks. Yeah, I don't know. So triples, let's do this. Guys, I'm gonna need you all. So one over there, one over here. Marty, you go at the net. So one of the things that I'm gonna hopefully convince you of, and I learned this along the way, you guys are gonna line up like for doubles with an extra guy returning. So Ken, you're back. Ken, you go behind Ken. Enrique, you're at the net. Okay, so watch. Here's a big takeaway. Well, I'll tell you what, I'm gonna tell you the takeaway in a minute. So right now, this drill, the purpose of it is for transition. Okay, people coming to the net. But I'm gonna show you the three ways. So the first time is you're gonna start from the blue line. Ken, you start there. This is called, the drill is called triples, by the way, it's a doubles drill. And notice where Dave is, okay? Here's the rules of the game. You have to feed across court and you gotta come in. Ken, after that it's a live ball. You'll probably wanna return across court mostly, but you can pump it down the line. And you play to win, okay? Play to win and then rotate one spot on your own half. Ready, go. Notice the launching pad. Play it up. Okay, quickly rotate on your own half. Come way up here. This is what I would do for 2-5s, 3-0s. Because if you have them launch from the baseline, wow, that feels good. If you have launch from the baseline, that's a little tough on. Okay, so I'm making it easy. This is kind of a warm-up version. My spin-off lessons, by the way, would be what? What I like to do in this game is park myself over by the returner and preach to them how they should hit the ball low and not necessarily hard. Okay, so here we go. Oh, we have a little moment, squirrel moment over there. Okay, keep going, keep going. The way this drill would unfold, coaches, by the way, is that after a set number of minutes or time, I would have the people switch in. We do forehand, backhand. But timeout, that's just one variation. Kind of like an easier variation. This is the next variation, a little bit tougher. You're gonna go back, and this is huge. No footfall thing, okay? So you're gonna feed the ball across court, and you're gonna launch. You're probably gonna get right between these two lines. You're gonna have a transition volley, but here's the deal. How many of you, by raising your hands, have ever had a conversation like this with any of your club players? Here's the conversation. I'm on my drama team at church, right? Dude, you gotta go with the net. Who's ever said that? I mean, you want them coming in, and it's like, eh. And then here's their response. Yeah, but I have this new theory. I think only I figured it out. I'm the first person ever. This isn't gonna work. I'm gonna wait a shot. And then I'm gonna come in, because then I don't. You ever heard that? Okay, so this drill is, the purpose of it is to get lots of reps. So I would sit there with my players thinking, dude, you're just trying to ruin my life, aren't you? No, I really didn't. And they wouldn't come in. Here's the deal. They weren't trying to ruin my life. They were scared, crapless, of this transition volley. They miss a little ball. They find me. I knew it. Chubby guy told me to go in. I should do. Okay, so we just need reps. This drill is all about reps. I want in the next 20 minutes, and we're not going to do it for 20, that my players will get 100 balls coming in, okay? So the key is you have to hit from behind the line, then launch. So now you're gonna get a more difficult one. Okay, go ahead, Ken, get it low if you can. Dip it down in his toe, nice, play it. Every time that happens, I'm gonna call a timeout. Here's what's gonna happen. Dave got an extra shot, he missed it. Before he can start to complain, I sweep in. Dude, that's exactly what your drill's supposed to teach. Come on, man, this is awesome. Give him a little fuel kick for happiness, and then go. Perfect, that's the way to get a low, guys. Look at all these reps we're getting down there. Nice, they crack me. Okay, there they go. Nice cut. Oh, yes. It sounded like a shank, but it was on purpose. Oh, we need a player. Okay, time. Let's beef it up to the 4-5 level. Now what's gonna happen is you're gonna feed the ball across court, but you cannot launch until it bounces on that side. That's gonna be tough, but your natural instinct will be to go. So this is for sure gonna put him in a very tough spot. If you get a nice volley, I'd be very surprised. So feed it, wait, go. Look at what I just did to him. I screwed him basically, right? So keep going. Go, wait, you get it. Okay, no problem. So this is the same drill, guys. This is called triples, but you can do it two, three, four different ways. Nice pickup. Oh yeah, love it. Wait. Good move. Nice pickup. That's my wife, you guys. Okay, time out. All right. Show of hands again. Do you guys know what a drill killer is? Raise your hand if you have them at your club. You guys have pictures in your mind already of that snake.
Very.
Okay. Drill killer is a guy that finds a way to screw up every drill. He's got some rule. Hey, you didn't say I had to do that, you know. So the drill killer, either that or they have a crappy effort. So here's how the drill killer will get you in this drill. I'll say, hey guys, you got a launcher back here, and they'll cheat. Okay, I'm ready. You ready? Can't hear it. Go, I'm ready. And then, okay, I'm ready. Then they cheat from way up here. It's super easy. I'm sweet at the net. I go, no, you're not. You're a big fat cheater. You haven't even done it right. Okay, let's go on to the next drill, squirrel crossing. Okay, squirrel crossing is a game that I came up with because I wanted to teach our juniors in particular some little mini kind of skills. Okay, I was getting frustrated that all my juniors, their mini tennis skills are pretty non-existent. It's gonna be a little tough to do this game, I'll take that DVD, because we need some space around the post, which we don't have right now, but we're gonna fake it. Okay, so you two guys, service line, Kent, you're by the post. Marty, you're his partner. I need you two guys here. Both of you right here. I'm gonna take this over here, I think. I'll keep it right here. Okay, so here's the rules of the squirrel crossing. Your team, they are a team. And the third team is split here, they're these guys, okay? So I'm gonna feed a ball, I'm gonna feed a trick shot, by the way, I'm gonna go like this and feed behind me. And even though the home court is good, if I do this shot to McKenzie, I don't wanna see this top spin craziness, I wanna see that he has some skills. A practical, normal person would probably cut that back and do some mini tennis. The rules are you cannot hit my feet in the air, but after that anything goes. You can lob if you want, but be careful. So if I have that rule, I can't feed like this, because that's illegal. But I might feed like that and you have to let it bounce, okay? Here's why it's called squirrel crossing. Whichever team loses, okay, they go out. If you lose, you're gonna split though. Don't go beat buddies and split. If you lose, you'll split. Marty and Ken, they don't know if they're coming in that way or coming in this way. Marty, will you demonstrate the squirrel moment? You go this way, oh, there's a squirrel in the street. She doesn't know what the hell she's doing. He goes back and forth, this way, oh no, wrong way. No, wait, I'm this way. So that's why you gotta pay attention. Okay, mini tennis point, are you ready? Play to win, go. Losing team bails out. Okay, go this way. This, by the way, coaches, yeah, the home court is good. By the way, coaches, this is the 4-5 version. This is the higher version. We're going in reverse. Nice try. Okay, so they're out. Then I do one of these head fakes. Nice. Anything goes. Oh, yes, they're out. Okay, bounce it. I would hit it higher normally. Duke it out. Okay, they're out. Look at this. Trick shot. Nice, Kent. Matt, you did good. Okay, over here, head fake. Oh, the head fake was awesome. You're out, buddy. Get over here. I actually hurt my neck on that head fake. Are you ready? Right over here behind me. Whoa. No, that we call a left. This is the goblin got in the net. Okay, ready? Here you go, Marty. So anything goes. I would pump this way up. You gotta let that bounce stay. Come on out. So more often than not, nice. That's what I'm looking for. These little, like, get ready, coach. I'm gonna feed like this. If I hit that, 9 out of 10 of us would probably hit that with underspin because we're smart, okay? A lot of club juniors or club rec players, they would hit that with some ridiculous topspin that's not gonna stay in. So, what do you think? Could I do that drill with my three old ladies? Because it's too cardio. It's way too cardio. The first, I'll tell you the history of this drill actually, it's interesting. The first time I did it, it didn't go that good at my club. And the kids were still too scatterbrained, they didn't know what was going on. I kind of killed it. Came back to it a month later, it was a big hit. My kids loved it. To the point where they asked for it all the time. Or when we finished this round, like, oh, one more round. I Okay, but then I got real smart. I said, I'm going to do this with a women's team because they need to do that mini tennis. And I did the one ball rotate and I had a heart attack. With all six of them, we had one heart attack together. Okay, so I realized, well, that drill, maybe you can't fit. So here's the tweak, okay? This is maybe for my 3-5 team. It's the same drill, but instead of one ball, you're going to play two balls. And only the second ball will determine who goes out. Okay, now I want you guys to pay attention to the intensity level, which should go down. It'll be less running in and out. Here we go. Crappy feet. Nice get. Sorry, Ken, I made you pull something. Ready? So you guys split. You're out of there. Oh, yeah. I don't know my own drill. Now pay attention to what I'm saying. That's rough when you don't know your own drill. Okay, this is the second ball. Nice. Love it. Love it. The man. Okay, you guys are trying. You're unbelievable. Woo. Okay, now they lost the second ball. They bailed off. Look at Dave. Dave brought a season right away. Nice little carver. Okay, one more. Here we go, Ken. You got it. Show me something smart. Nice touch, baby. Oh, yeah. This could be one of the... Nice. You guys are out of there. Marty got 10 pounds. So that's two balls, right? You see what's happened to the cardio. Okay, time. So I did the two-ball version, and I can do it with some of my women's teams in particular, but not my 3-0 senior team. They were still having the minor heart attack, like an arrhythmia. Okay, so now I did a three-ball thing. Ready? So now it's three balls, and then only the third ball will rotate. Here we go. Okay, good. Second ball right here. I almost forgot. So third ball right here, head fake. Nice get. Oh, I love it. But you guys miss or you're out. Here comes Ken DeHart. Okay, good. Here we go, Dave. And as a feeder, I can get super creative. That was rough. Sorry. I screwed you a little bit, but you're out. Okay, here we go. Okay, ready? Off the cart. Catch it. That almost came back on. Okay, nice. Third ball. Woo! Oh, nice. Oh, yes! So reassure Poland lifting. I love it. Okay, good. Good enough. I don't want to spend too much time on one drill. You get the idea. So that's called squirrel crossing. The origin was my frustration that our juniors really didn't seem to have any. They get a ball up in the air and they were lost. Okay, we're going to skip a couple of these because I swapped out a couple of new ones. This next one I want to do is called Who's Your Daddy? Who's Your Daddy? Okay, so I need Marty right in the middle, and Ken and Enrique to go behind her. I tell you what, let's just do this. Ken, you take a break because I want to try it with two people. You two guys go over here. All right, so this is kind of a passing shot drill. All right, so get my grandpa glasses here. Okay, so Ken, you're going to start right here on Mackie, right here in the T. And Marty, you're going to start right here. I'm going to show you the easy version first. So passing shot drill, I'm going to feed Marty. You're going to hit a passing shot, and then you're going to play out the point, and then I'll just feed you a second point. After two points are done, you two players switch ends, okay? But there's a way you can double up your point. If you win a point and you win a point, that's a split, okay? Just switch. But if you win both, or if you win both, you can choose to get a bonus point. You know how you get a bonus point? You gotta yell out loudly, "Who's your daddy?" Because you just hold the guy for 2 points. But if you're too shy, or if it's emotionally going to ruin you, then don't do it. Just don't get to the point. Okay, ready? Here we go. Play to win. Uh-oh, she's there. She's crafty. Uh-oh. Wiener. Don't hurt her. Okay. Second. Great point. Okay, switch hands. Yes, that's a bonus. Okay, so watch. Mackie, you go over there. Marty comes over here. Good, way to be brave, man. You're not a lot of people would do that. Okay, here we go. Ooh, you're wrong-footed him a little bit. Okay, nice. That's a split. No one can, okay, Marty comes up. Maggie, you play Marty? Okay, nobody likes He plays at UCLA, maybe you can take him. Okay, that's a split, so there's no scoring. I mean, these get one, but there's no bonus point. Here we go, Dave. Yep, ready, another feed. That was horrible. Split, oh, bummer. Okay, here we go, Marty, get him. Here we go, Marty. Yes. Okay, so that would be maybe 3-0 level, okay? But to make this a little bit tougher, I would have you start in the corner. I would have you start in either corner, I don't care which one. Just for the first ball, I have to start out of position, so there's a little bit of maybe hitting behind the guy or not. So 2 balls, ready? Go. Play it out. Okay, now you stay right in the middle. You only have to do that for the first ball. Ball two. I want to see what those wins. Okay, either corner. Here we go, Marty. Okay, you stay right in the middle for the second. Sorry, that was rough. Did he win two? Did he win both? Yeah, so you want to bonus one? No, he's all right. Thank you. That'll make me have a better life later. Okay, good. Second ball.
Push it, Dad.
Oh, bonus point. Okay, now. They just earned a bonus point for saying it. So all you have to do is just teach them to fire up a little bit. Now, guys, the most advanced version would be you got to start the corner for the first ball. And then as soon as the point's over, you gotta start the corner again. Whatever corner you're closest to, go to. So let's just show a couple like that. This is maybe for 4 or 5 or advanced juniors. So you play it out, get in either corner, doesn't matter which one, I feed it accordingly. And then you play it out, switch ends. Either corner, here they go, go. Okay, they find the corner, they're both over here. So basically, there's the bonus. I've just made it tougher. It's the same drill, okay? Now, let's go to the next one. I don't want that one. I'm gonna go to a different one. Okay, Marty, will you put up the nets or the lines for 6 targets? Okay, so coaches, I don't know if this happens at your club, but I think it probably does. You're doing a drill, a junior drill, a 2-hour class, a group lesson, whatever you call it. Let's get everybody over here, guys. And during that time, you have your own practice for serve practice. Okay, for me, for years, I would teach a clinic during the winter in Michigan from 4 to 6. That's when the after school lessons are. The kids would come in, we get them warmed up, we start drilling. Sometime between 5:20 and 5:30, I usually said something like this. Ball pickup, serve practice. Right? And it was weird, but it was, I think the kids heard, start moving real slow and start talking. Because they were like, oh, yeah. And they were serving just like the same kid who was just crying literally because the serve let him down. He's out there like this. Yeah, and then that one kid said that his car was broken. There's nothing good about it. So, I have come up with some drills that would actually, A, make the kid want to serve, and B, be useful. So obviously, if you score something, kids are more interested. So I'm going to teach you, you stand in the areas. I'm going to teach you this little game called the serve number game. It's basic, but super effective, I think. And what I do at my club is I just kind of, we have a simple targeting system. I like to say I'm better than this, I'm sure someone else did. So the lines just are the borders. So Marty right now is standing in area 1. That's the whole target area. And she slides to her left. This is the area 2 between those two. Then area 3, now she's there over here, is area 4, and then 5, and then 6. Okay, so very basic. But every kid in my club knows what I mean. If I see him in the street and they go, hey, how's your search at area 6? And they know what I'm talking about. So we all have this common language. Now the game is interesting. I'm gonna come up and serve, and I'm gonna serve to area 1, and I have to go to area 1 until I hit it, which hopefully will be soon. And then I move on to 2, then 3, then 4, then 5, then 6, and that's my game. And then I play several games. Okay, so I'm going to put my reputation line here, play one in front of you. So here we go. In area one, I'll take it. Area two, I'm on fire. Area three, I think it was it. Oh. Is there a camera rolling? That's, I missed, right? So I'm stuck on three here. I was trying to go for three. That's the wrong one. Go to three. Crap, it was right there. Three. Three, okay? Now I get to move on to what? Four. And how many zeros have I hit so far? I think six. Okay, I'm going to area four. Area four, George. Area five. Crap, area five. On my website, I got to do six. Okay, I'm on number five. Got it. Not long, it was long, but I'll tell you. Six. I'll take it. You be quiet. Okay, so that was not a great game. It was 12 or something. And then I play another game. And then I play another game. And then kids want to know what? What'd you get, Selkie? You didn't get seven. No way. And they start battling. Now, if you have multiple kids on the court, have half of them start at four, five, and six, and finish up with one, two, three, so you can get more bodies going through here. But that game, anybody want to try it?
You did, Jorge.
Yeah. So that's a really good one. So Dave, you're going to go over there, and Ricky, you're going to go over here. Let's get you guys on that half right there. Colin and Ken, you're going to come right here. We're going to give Marty and Ken a break right now. So this is a game for consistency. Consistency. Hey, kids, you want to work with consistency? Mm. Is there any broken glass that can even stick? So you're going to go right here. You guys are right here. And Maggie, you're going to go over there. And Kyle, you're going to go over here. So these two guys are going to be sparring straight ahead. And you guys are going to be sparring straight ahead. Now, this is a consistency battle. So here's how you win the point. Okay? There's two ways, actually. One way is as you start your rally, you have to have a simultaneous start. If your rally lasts longer than their rally, you win the point. But, can you see what a drill killer would do? A drill killer would go. So the other way you can win this is if you get to 10 balls in before they get to 10 balls in. That'll fix the drill killer. Okay. So again, either way, you either keep your rally going longer than theirs, or one of your teams gets a 10. This is one ball in, okay? So are you ready? I need you to start simultaneously. We're going to keep track. This side versus this side. The drill is called consistency battle. Go. Just trying to extend the rally.
If the ball's an inch out, it's out. You gotta call it like you wanna win. Alright? So don't just keep it going, go. My buddy and
Watch for that. And this is for 1 million points. And free cheesecake at Junior's downstairs for the winning team. This is one more round. Ready? Go. So it's just a game, just made it competitive, and we're trying to get kids to learn that consistency in a little bit of fun way as opposed to the way I did it. Here's how I did, well not I, this is what was done before me by my coach. Yes, good enough, guys. I don't know if I like it or not. I know I didn't personally like it. When I was a junior, our coach John would say, okay, here we go. Everybody warmed up. He pushes all on the court, and as soon as me and whoever got 100 balls in a row, not 100 photo, in a row, then we can join the drill. Guess how fun that was for me most days. Normally not fun, okay? I could do 100, but I was pushing, I was cheating, okay? Several times in my 90s, I missed, and then the guy was super moral, and he didn't want to cheat. I'm like, come on, we close enough. No, we were 96. Okay, so that's one way to work on it, but in my experience, it's not that much fun if it's just go up to 100. And I don't know how many shots it takes to go to 100. Anyway, okay. Death coding. So I'm going to show you something that's relatively new. I'll keep you players out here. So I like to talk about the court being in zones. This is kind of an awareness game. So if we take this front court here, we chop it in half. This would be zone one, and I'm standing in zone two. This back is actually chopped already. So this is zone three, this is zone four. This, we're gonna chop. Zone five, zone six, imaginary line right here, okay? So one little drill, this is called depth coding, D-E-P-T-H coding, it's not your handout. Dave, I'm just gonna have you guys go for the purpose of demo, and you're gonna call out loud wherever his ball lands. Okay, so if it lands here, right where it lands, you go four, and you rally it back. You keep the rally going. Now, before you start, I recommend you ask the kids, what do you think more, where do you think more balls are gonna land? And they will say usually what? Most of the balls are gonna land three and four. And after they do the drill, they realize way more balls land two and three. Okay, so just so we can all be on the same page, go ahead and get a rally going. Two, three, three, four, four. Okay, do it again. Simple. Three, three, two, two, three, three, two, two, four, four. Okay, stop. So you get the idea? Super great drill to create awareness because a lot of kids don't really ever pay attention to where the ball comes. So what I want you to do is activate both halves, okay, and just rally. I'm just going to let you play on your own. And both of you have to be talking about all four players coming. Okay, go. So coaches, as they're hitting, I'll talk to you. You as a coach, you can preach what you believe as far as that. There's a lot of people that will tell you that any card or zone four is not the best thing. Some people say, hey, you got a high level, you cannot do the ball in zone three. Zone three will kill you at the highest level. And you don't think that. And you do. I'm not trying to convince you one way or the other. I'm just trying to get you to do this drill to create awareness. Almost for sure, maybe even here, you see there's more two balls than not. There's more two balls than you realize. Okay, stop. Good job, guys. Now, here's my follow-up conversation with the kids usually. I bring them in for a hug. Kids, come on in. All right, what'd you learn? Did you hit as deep as you thought? What do they say? No, I hit shorter than I thought. Okay, is that going to be a problem? No, everybody hits when I hit short, they miss. Oh, good, you're one of the lucky few. That's not normally what's going to happen. So, we'll talk a little bit, just see. But here's what I want them to think. Now we're getting into the strategy. If Dave and I are rallying, how many have a ball machine in your club? You have a ball machine, okay? Ball machine is a beautiful thing for certain things. If I have a shot that I want to groove out, the ball machine is a great way because it'll send it, it kind of closes the environment. And if I set the ball machine settings, where do I usually have the ball bouncing? Two, three, or four? Usually the ball will bounce at three and clear the baseline where waist high. And in a matter of minutes, I'm feeling pretty good. Oh, my money is actually pretty good. Just like Federer, man. Look at that. So, but as we are players, we are ball machines. So if I look at you and I say, what's your personal ball machine setting? Are you maybe making that guy play too good? He goes, I don't get it. Ball machine settings is how you send the ball. And if you're sending balls that land in three near the baseline, and then you're probably one of those players that go, God, everybody trees against me. These guys just play their mind. So don't. Here's the deal. Be the anti-ball machine. You're never going to be the ball machine. So now, just that little tip, it's like, what are your personal settings? I mean, you tell me. You know, I'm set to hit the ball at four. Well, you think so, but maybe the wheel is worn out. It's only going to two every time. All right, so this can be done cooperatively, can be done competitive. I'm going to show you a little game here, because I can add tactics to this. You're going to rally. I'm going to give you a mission. I want you, wherever possible, to push Dave back to six. Make him enter zone six with his body. So what do you think you're going to have to do that? High boogie balls, probably not line drives, okay? Now, he just heard that, but I wouldn't know what to tell him. Then I might say to Dave, here's how you score your mission. Every single time that you bring him to the net, and he stays at the net, you get a point. Or maybe it's different. Maybe I say, hey, Dave, every time you get a ball in zone two, you have to go in. That's just the rule. You come in, you score the mission. All right, so let's do that. That's your goal. Anything in two, you're going to come in. Anything you can push it back, you're going to score. And over here, guys, let's do the exact same thing. All right, and now they're actually hitting, but now they've got some tactical stuff going on, hopefully. Like, hey, I'm going to try to push the guy back, or I'm going to be not the guy as a ball machine. Pretty good.
What do you think we're wrong on that one?
Eric, well, nothing. I think it was a great decision. And you were here, right? And how hard did you hit that? About nine. Okay, that's green, right? Do you hit greens from here? Greens are kind of reserved for up here, unless you're some freak or something. So it opens the door for a lot of coaching. Here's the analogy I usually make as a follow-up to that. I'll bring the kids in, I'll go, guys, I actually have this on my TV at the club. I have the French Open, and I have a match on there with Rafa. And Rafa plays this great point, he's playing Djokovic, it's like a 20-some ball rally, and both players are doing some amazing shots. The point ends with Novak getting a short ball, Rafa moves way up into here like three, and pummels a forehand and, you know, kills it, and it's a winner. Okay, so I stop the camera, or I stop the TV, and I say, okay, what do you think about that point? And what do they all say? Oh, that was Rocco, man, he really killed that ball. That was the last image they saw. And then I do the old rewind. And guess what? I said, now we're gonna color code it. You've got Grog and looking at the same TV. We're gonna color code this together. And during that same 23 ball rally, Rafa had like 17 yellows, like four reds, two greens. The last one was the green, that was the image, but those kids would have walked out of there without me making that point, thinking, what? Well, I knew it. I gotta get better at my greens. Yeah. And you don't. You gotta get better at your stinking yellows and reds. That's what's gonna make you famous. And hopefully your greens are reliable. Okay, one more drill. Let's have all the players in the net on that side. And while we're at it, let's pick up just a few balls or tries so we don't kill ourselves. Okay, thank you. So, I'm going to try this with great hope. You're all going to start at the single file line. And Dave Brower, will you come up here first? Guys, just line up in the alley here, because I want to show you this in a minute. But I'm going to teach you some cool feeds that I've learned from a buddy that I think are super helpful. Here's my model. The better the player, the tougher the feed, okay? So if I ever feed too nasty, and it's a winner, I just say, I think you're really good. So, here's how we always feed the lob in particular to really good players. From the side, we just pump it up there. And often, they're just getting these way unrealistically too easy shots. And they hit winners, and sometimes the drills won't even go. So, we'll see if this court allows it. But if I could, instead of feed this, get a little tighter, don't go for this one, I'm still testing my, oh my gosh. That was dangerous, okay? By hitting it down, it has a lot of topspin. I bet Mackie gets topspin lobs all the time. I'm not sure if my three-year-old ladies are, but for his level, I wouldn't be feeding too much like this. I think it's more effective to do that because that's what he's dealing with and the ball coming down quicker. So, we're gonna do the flying sampler drill. So you're gonna start out by the tee, Dave. You guys all file in behind. So this is a one and done drill, gonna go fast. So guys over here, put on your helmet. Okay, so get real close. I'm gonna go like this. First one, just hit it overhead. Oh, that was horrible. More like a volley. And then circle to the end of the line. Okay, the line has to be ready. It's way up there. Get way up there. Oh, there it was. Okay. He's going to phase two. Okay, once they get the hang of it. Nice. Alright, now we're going to do the flank. So I would have that from here. Another variation that I haven't touched the tape and I said them all backwards with these little tough ones. Okay, then I said them here. Now we're gonna do it for fun. Remember how Pete used to jump up and do, you know, like some yeah, and then hit an overhead? You're gonna try that, and then we're gonna laugh when you're not doing well. Ready? Here we go. Sky, oh, yes, you almost had it. That was the old drop shot. Oh, he's got some talent. Yes. I think that overhead has some Tourette's. Good. Now, go back to the baseline just at the point. Staying on this idea of feed. If I have really good players, do I feed this for their grounding? Well, maybe because I care bad, but that is not a nice feed. This, however, is this, see how that jumped up on him? It only takes a few seconds to get the hang of that. And almost always, my really good player, that's like a high league junior, when I'm feeding like this, all right, I feed it normal, he's just keying off. When I do this, I call that the rocker ball. It comes over like an egg. This, I mean, this got nasty spin. So, one and done, ready? Here's your nasty topspin forehand, get out. Here's Marty. Oh, that's rough. Yes. So they'll learn sooner or later. It's tough, right? Are they doing well? Let's just mock them. No, they're not doing very good. But that's because that thing is jumping. So this knee, or I can do it like this. How's that going to go for a couple hours? Yeah. If I hit it down like this, it'll just take you a second to feed it into your arsenal. Whoa, nice and loud. Over there. All right, good. So, guys, let's do this. Can you all pick up 12 balls each? Coaches, never say ball pick up. Say pick up X number of balls quickly. Did I tell them to jog? For some reason, they're all jogging right now. All right, and that's kind of what happened. Oh, sorry, I don't have enough time. I got time.